Let's take our Bibles and return to the book of Joshua, Joshua chapter 24, with a cross-reference in Ephesians chapter number 2. So if you'll find Joshua 24 and also Ephesians chapter 2, Joshua chapter 24, Ephesians chapter number 2. Well, at last, the committee defined what biblical exposition is. They've been working on it for some time. And they came up with this definition: communicating the meaning of a Bible text or passage of Scripture in terms of contemporary culture, with the specific goal of helping people to understand and obey the truth of God. And that's pretty good. That's a pretty good definition for biblical exposition. Now, Joshua here, he would have understood and readily concurred, I believe, in that definition. I mean, he was not called to be a preacher. He wasn't, really. He was a soldier, in fact, a general, as he worked his way up through the ranks in the Israeli army back in those days under Moses, and then took command himself. He was an administrator, an organizer, but he wasn't called to be a preacher necessarily. But as he drew near the end of his life, and as he looked ahead to the temptations that he knew would come to God's people, and that they would be tempted to depart from the worship of the true God after he died, he turned to preaching in an attempt to help God's people be as faithful to God as possible. And he preached as one of the great Puritan preachers once described himself, as a dying man preaching to dying men. We have three sermons of Joshua in the closing three chapters of this book that bears his name. Chapter 22, he preached a sermon on vigilance and unity. Stay at it and stay together. And in chapter 23, he preached a sermon on the dangers of being one of the crowd. Don't let the culture master you, but you master the culture. Say amen.
Amen.
And then finally, as we come to chapter 24, he's going to bring us a message. And this is an old man, a dying man, really trying to look out for God's people. And he's going to bring us a message here, we're going to look at it, on remembering from where we've come and on staying on track by God's grace. Biblical history begins with God's grace making the first move. I want us to understand this. Look at Joshua chapter 24 and verse number 1. And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem, and he called for the elders of Israel, for their heads, for their judges, for their officers, and they all presented themselves before God. And Joshua said unto all the people, thus says the Lord God of Israel, your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood. Now he's referring back, way back to the time of Abraham on the other side of the Euphrates before they even came over and looked at the promised land in Israel. He said, your forefathers dwelt on the other side of the flood of the river Euphrates, over in the modern-day land of Iraq and Iran. They're all from over in that area. In the old time, your fathers dwelt there. Even Terah, the father of Abraham, and the father of Nahor. And they served other gods. They were idolaters. Sticks and stones, various gods made up by the Babylonians. Philippians and what have you over there. And I took, speaking as God through Joshua Houston, I took your father Abraham from the other side of that flood. We'll stop right there. Grace is the unmerited favor of God. We don't earn it. We can't buy it. It's just the unmerited favor of God. That's what grace is.
Amen.
And the Lord's good pleasure is the only reason that God called Abraham. As Joshua is kind of rehearsing where we've come from, he wants everyone to realize that Abraham was a vile, idolatrous pagan from the word go. He was back in the, he was just as much an idolater and a pagan as anybody else. Abraham was no more exempt from the guilt of idolatry than Terah or Nahor, his father and others that are part of his family. So I think it's incorrect for us to look upon folks like Abraham as if they deserved God's grace. There is a persistent tendency in church circles to look back on the Bible characters and to, like Abraham, and to kind of view them as a kind of a Mr. Goodrich kind of a guy. You know, he was a swell guy. He was a good man. And we think if God had an ounce of wisdom, he couldn't help but taking a shine to Abraham. He was already halfway there. Abraham was a good guy. And we picture Abraham already disposed toward God. And we believe that he was already on the way to truth. And all Abraham needed was just a little nudge and just a little help from God to finish a conversion so nobly begun by himself. Not true. The truth is that there's a people of God at all hangs on the single strand of God's good pleasure.
Amen.
And God's good grace.
Amen.
For no apparent reason, God spoke to Abraham. Just out of his grace, out of his wisdom, in his plan and purpose, God spoke to Abraham, the sinner. Look again at verse number 3, the first part of verse 3, where God says, I took your father, Abraham, from the other side of the flood. I did it. It is my work. I made the first move. That's where I want you to pick up the cross-reference in Ephesians chapter 2. Look at Ephesians chapter 2. And Paul writes to the church here in Ephesians describing what we were before God came along. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 1, Paul writes, and you has he quickened. And that's an old Elizabethan English word from the time of Queen Elizabeth there. Quickened means to make alive. And you has he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, that's the devil, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience, that's our flesh. So we have the world, the devil, and the flesh, and that's how we acted. That's what we did, that's how we lived. Among whom also we all had our conduct and conversation in times past, and we lived in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and we were by nature, in our very nature, were the children of wrath, deserving of judgment and punishment, even as others. But God.
Amen.
But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were He has spiritually made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you are saved. And he's raised us up together, made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace, not our moral aptitudes. Going to show exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves. It is entirely the gift of God, not of works, your good deeds, your good looks, your moral aptitude, not of works, lest any man should boast. That's the way it was with Abraham, that's the way it is with us. You don't get to heaven and say, yes, I believe Jesus, but I lived good enough, I deserve my spot up here. You don't say that in heaven, if you understand the Bible. You don't say that. We do not say it. Abraham could say, it all started with God. It all started there in unexpected, unimaginable, and unexplainable grace. And the only motivation, you say, well, what would motivate God to do that? The only motivation that he reveals in the scripture is that he loves us, say amen. And because he loves us, he reaches out to us to give us that free gift of salvation if we will believe what he has done for us, say amen.
Amen.
So to stay on track, we must forever remember what we were and what we would still be if it wasn't for the grace of God. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Joshua is about, in this sermon, to remind God's people in his message here about the characteristics of God's grace. And this will help us so much in our understanding of how God deals with us. If we follow here his sermon and his words, the pace of God's grace. P-A-C-E. The pace of God's grace is gradual. Look back at Joshua chapter 23. And the last part now, verse number 3. We stopped after reading the first part where Joshua wrote, God saying, I took your father Abraham from the other side of the flood and led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his descendants, multiplied his seed, and gave him Isaac. And I gave unto Isaac Jacob and Esau. And we'll stop right there. God does what he promises. You believe that?
Amen.
God does what he promises, but sometimes so gradually that we actually question his faithfulness. We just get so impatient in waiting for it. And look at verse 3 again, the last part of verse 3. It struck me as really kind of funny as you read it, because it says that God multiplied his seed, Abraham's seed, and after 25 years he had one child. God multiplied it, and he had one after 25 years. And then Isaac, that one child, Isaac and Rebekah waited 20 years for Jacob and Esau. And so you got God multiplied their seed, and after 45 years, they have 3 children. That just struck me as kind of funny. Maybe it's just me. I don't know. But when you multiply, I thought he would have a whole lot more after 45 years. Anyway, God does not work on our calendar. That's the point. God does not work on our this poster, and they were in various positions, laughing wildly. They're holding their sides, and the caption read, "You want it when?" It was supposed to be a subtle message to those impatient students who came into the office actually expecting that their records should have been ready the day before they arrived. And it was just, "You want it when?" And I thought that was funny. Y'all need some help this morning, I'll tell you what. God does not work on our calendars. "You want it when?" Our faith would be helped by focusing on the fact of God's grace rather than on its degree or speed. It would help us. As Joshua's trying to get God's people to be helped in, he's helping us now. Focus on the fact that God has given us his grace.
Amen.
And let him work in his own time and ways. Amen.
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 We lose sight of what God has done by demanding too much too soon. God, jump through that hoop. Answer my prayer today. God's grace is gradual. The pace of God's grace is gradual. We have to remember that. To stay on track, we have to forever remember where we were and where we would still be if it wasn't for the grace of God. Now, we're back at some more of Joshua's sermon here. I want you to see not only the pace of God's grace is gradual, but the direction of God's grace is mystifying. You can't figure out the mind of God. If you could figure out the mind of God, you'd be God. And we just can't figure out the mind of God. Look at the last part of verse number 4 of Joshua 23, where God says at the beginning, I gave unto Isaac, Jacob, and Esau, and I gave unto Esau Mount Seir. That was on the east side of the Jordan River, the Edom area there in Bible land. So he gave that whole mountainous area there to live and possess it. But to Jacob and his children, I sent them down into Egypt. Now here's the crazy part about God's grace that so many times us believers, we have great deal of difficulty with. This is the mystifying puzzle. We often have to wait in great distress for God's promised blessings. But everybody else seems to be giving them right away. Now, what's up with that? Esau and his family, the non-promised son, the non-covenant line, they get their inheritance, they live a prosperous life, go on about their business, and they're over there. While the covenant family, the promised son, Jacob and company, they end up going down to Egypt for 400 years of slavery. Does that sound right? In our human minds, that sounds like it's reversed. It seems like the good guys should get all the good stuff right away, and the bad guys ought to be sent down to Egypt. But it's just the exact opposite. This God's grace is mystifying. Why do the believers experience hardship and slavery, while others enjoy rewards in this life? Why do God's chosen people, the chosen ones, us, why do we experience affliction while others enjoy the good things of this life in this world?
honesty in the Bible, he reveals this to us. He reveals to us that in his grace, we actually may meet with darkness and adversity and trial and affliction. Some of us do, some of us don't. Now, Hebrews chapter 11, you just look there. It is the definitive passage in my mind, because as you read Hebrews chapter 11, you see all these people of faith. And then towards the latter part of the chapter, he says that God's people conquered kingdoms, shut lions' mouths, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the sword, routed armies, observed resurrections. And then in the middle of that list, he said, yet others of God's people were tortured, faced jeers and flogging, were stoned, sawn in two, were made destitute, persecuted and mistreated, and lived in caves and holes in the ground because they had no place to stay. But they're still God's people. And he says in Hebrews chapter 11, this world is not worthy of God's people. You say, well, my goodness, what makes the difference? I mean, we're taught, and generally it is true, I want you to understand, generally it's true, when we live a righteous life before God, then there are rewards and blessings that come to us. But I want you to understand that the man Job lived the very best life, and he had everything go wrong. It happens. And you say, why? The mind of God, God's grace. But regardless of what God is doing, whether we face adversity or prosperity, whether we have bad times or whether we have good times, God's grace will always hold us and sustain us through. Do you believe that? Say amen.
Amen.
That's why I'm trying to say that this will help us as we are facing the trials and troubles of life that are coming, that are here or that are coming. If we will understand the direction of God's grace is mystifying, yes. Why do some people have it easy and we have it hard? It's mystifying when that happens, but if we'll just cling to God's grace, he will sustain us. Say amen. Stay on track. We must forever remember what we were and what we would still be if it wasn't for the grace of God. So the pace of God's grace is gradual. The direction of God's grace is mystifying. The power of God's grace is unlimited. Now look back at verse 5 of Joshua chapter 23 as he reminds our Joshua. As he reminds God's people here. Verse number 5. I sent Moses also and Aaron, and I plagued Egypt. He's going back through their history. According to that which I did among them, and afterward I, the Lord God of all heaven and earth, I brought you out, and I brought your fathers out of Egypt. And you came unto the sea, the Red Sea, and the Egyptians pursued after your fathers with chariots and horsemen, the whole army, unto the Red Sea. And then he changes the perspective and he said, when they cried, God's people cried unto the Lord, God put darkness between you and the Egyptians and brought the sea upon the Egyptians and covered them. And your eyes have seen what I have done in Egypt. Skip down to verse 8. And I brought you into the land of the Amorites, which dwelt on the other side of the Jordan River. And they fought with you, and I gave them into your hand, that you might possess their land, and I destroyed them before you. Skip down to verse 11. And you went over the Jordan River, and you came unto Jericho. And the men of Jericho fought against you. The Amorites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, Midianites, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Hivites, the Jebusites, all these armies and little nations, they fought against you, and I deliver them into your hand. Verse 12, and I sent the hornet before you. Now that could be literal hornets, or it could be a metaphor for the panic and dread and fear. Either way or both, he sent that hornet before you, and I drove them out from before you, the two kings of the Amorites. But you didn't do it with your sword, and you didn't do it with your bow. The power of God's grace is unlimited. Every enemy that God's people faced, God delivered them. That's what he's reminding them. Don't you remember where we come from? Right now. Don't you remember how God has brought you through all those trials and troubles and tribulations? He brought you to where you are right now. He's the one who fought for us. God will sometimes box us in and make us helpless. Oh, listen, I've been there. You get down to the hospital, you get down to the funeral home, you get down to the deathbed, and you feel so helpless. You can't fix it. You can't repair it. God will sometimes box us up in our own helplessness just to show his power.
Right.
Both in Egypt and Canaan, God's people were made to be helpless, and the Lord wanted to show it was not by cleverness, it was not by human insight or wisdom, it was not by manipulation, it was not by worrying about it, but power comes from God. Say amen.
Amen.
We'll use our weapons and abilities in vain without the grace of God. Was a commentator in a Wojcik, and he said, the source of strength lies in God's grace, not in our willpower or in our spasms of earnestness. When we attempt to deliver ourselves through self-effort, we are like the man who tried to make his stalled sailing boat move by pushing against the mast. We exert ourselves a great deal, but we actually get nowhere. We can just get all up in the weather and nothing happens. Because it's not of us, it's of God. It is the grace of God that opens doors that no man can shut. And it's the grace of God that closes doors no man can open. Say amen.
Amen.
To stay on track, we've got to forever remember what we were and what we would still be if it wasn't for the grace of God. And Joshua is reminding Israel, and through them, he's reminding us the watch care of God's grace is ever present. He's always with us. Look at verse number 9. Back in chapter 24 of Joshua, verse number 9. Then Balak, the son of Zippor, king of Moab, he arose and warred against Israel. And Balak sent and called the prophet Balaam, the son of Beor, to curse Israel. Then God says, but I would not hearken unto Balaam, that prophet. Therefore, he actually blessed you instead of cursing you. He blessed you still. So I delivered you out of his hand. We need to realize that God's grace many times protects us from things we don't even see. If we know what God has kept us from and what He has kept from us, if He just pulls back that curtain and lets us see how He has shielded and protected us, oh my goodness, we have no trouble staying in line with the commandments of His Word. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
I mean, how many times have you have heard about an accident? And if you said, well, if they would only left 10 seconds later or 10 seconds sooner, that would have never happened. Well, how do you know that every single day we drive out of our driveways or we walk down the street, that 10 second, maybe even 2 second difference in our pace and in our speed, God has saved us from an early death? I'm telling you, God's watch care, the grace of God's watch care is ever present with us. And we need to see His grace to keep us in line and keep us on track. We stay on track. We must forever remember what we were and what we would still be if it wasn't for the grace of God.
Amen.
The pace of God's grace is gradual. The direction of God's grace is mystifying. The power of God's grace is unlimited. The watch care of God's grace is ever present. And the supply of God's grace is continuous. Look back again at the last part of verse 7. Last part of verse 7, Joshua chapter 24, the very last sentence where he said, and you dwelt in the wilderness a long season. And then in verses 8, he talks about where the Amorites had dwelt on the east side of the Jordan River. They fought, but I destroyed them from before you. Then he reminds them of the Balak and Balaam history and story. And then in verse 11, he talks about where they faced the walls of Jericho and all of those nations and evil people that they fought against in the promised land. He reminds them that God delivered them into your hand and took care of you then. And then how the hornet was sent before and they defeated. And all he reminds them of all of this. In verse 13, he says, I have given you a land for which you did not labor, and cities which you built not, and you dwell in them. And the vineyards and olive gardens which you planted not, do you eat, all because of my grace. The provisions of God for us are never ending. The very fact that we can breathe His air another breath is a testament of His grace. Verse 7, last part of verse 7, summarized half of the book of Exodus and all of the book of Numbers. You dwelt in the wilderness a long season. In fact, you go back and you read those chapters and you read those books. The Israelites survived from Egypt to Canaan. Their survival was one long miracle of God's grace. Surviving in a land flowing with milk and honey is just as much God's grace as surviving in the wilderness. So he said, even when you got to the promised land, verse 13, it was I that gave you your homes to live in. It's I that am giving you your food to eat. And we need to realize that and understand God's grace here also this morning.
Amen.
You combine the testimony of verse 7 and 13, and you see here is God's gracious provision. He's grace. He gives His grace. Verse 7, in the time of necessity when we're in the wilderness. And He also gives His grace in a time of abundance when we're in the promised land. So whether we're having adversity or prosperity, God's grace is what sustains us. God is so good. Say amen.
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 Stay on track. We have to forever remember what we were and what we would still be if it were not for the grace of God. So what is it that God wants us to remember? What does He want us to remember about His grace from the history of Israel here at Joshua 24? close your eyes right here and listen to my voice. Everyone's eyes are closed. Listen to my voice. And I'm simply going to rephrase Joshua's words to God's people in his day to us here today. This is God speaking directly to us. Listen closely as your eyes are closed. Thus says the Lord, remember how I took you as my own. Remember how I put you in a strait when you didn't know which way to turn, and I rescued you in your helplessness. Remember how I shielded you from dangers, both seen and unseen. Remember how I sustained you with bread and meat until this very day. Remember, by grace you are saved. And all God's people said,
amen.
Let's stand with our eyes closed and our heads bowed while you're standing. Let the musicians come. Maybe you're here and you've never experienced the saving grace of Almighty God. You don't have to shape up. You don't have to lean up. You don't have to spruce up. The living God of glory loves you and he invites you. Trust him just as you are. You say, well, I'm too big a sinner. The Bible says, when sin did abound, grace did much more abound. God's free pardoning grace is yours if you'd be willing to believe in the name and work of Jesus Christ for you. Would you come? Be willing to come to the altar and pray, trust in Jesus, and seek the face of God. You come. Someone from our church will meet you and show you from the Bible how to be a child of God, how to experience God's marvelous grace. Would you come? And then on the other hand, maybe you're here and once again, just the magnificence of God's grace has impressed your heart. Perhaps your life has taken on a realization that God has helped you through many dangers, toils, and snares, and he will continue to help you by his grace all the way home. Would you like to take this opportunity just to come to the altar of God and just worship him for the fullness of his grace and thank him once again for saving your soul? Would you come? Would you come?
Brother Robert, what number do we have? 343, Amazing Grace.
343. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now
and grace will lead me home.
this for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your marvelous grace. We don't understand it a lot of times. You work so gradually and over so many years that sometimes we think that you don't care, that you've forgotten us and abandoned us. But you always do what you promise to do. And sometimes, Lord, in your grace, we just don't understand why we have such a hard road and somebody that doesn't even care about the things of God has such an easy way. But Lord, we trust you that you know what's best. And like Job, who lost everything, we say with him, even though you slay me, yet will I trust you. Father, as we continue on our journey of faith, help us to realize and always remember that the power of your grace is unlimited, that the watch care of your grace is always with us, ever present, and the supply of your grace is continuous. Whether we're facing a smooth road or a bumpy road in life, help us to be faithful, God's people, always glorifying you in bad and in good, in adversity, in prosperity, in scarcity and in plenty. Help us always to be your child, understanding that everything you give in our life is through your good and gracious hand, and that you love us always with an everlasting love, and that by your grace we will be sustained until you take us home. Until you take us home. In Jesus' name. Let's sing that last verse.
And we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun. We've known less days to sing God's praise than
Lord, amen.
Amen.